Archbishop Salvatore Cordileone from the Archdiocese of San Francisco joins us now. Your Excellency, thank you so much for your time today. Great to be with you. As Eric just mentioned, you recently wrote an opinion piece in the Washington Post. You drew parallels between abortion and racial segregation. Talk to us more about that. I know that you are getting a lot of support from your brother bishops.
Yes, I have been pleased with that. Many bishops have tweeted support for my op-ed. Two bishops have asked me to reprint it in their diocesan publications. I've received emails. So I wanted to draw this parallel because at the middle of the last century, civil rights was the paramount human rights issue of that time. And we shudder in horror nowadays when we think about the treatment of African Americans in the pre-civil rights South. The immorality of it is so clear to us, and it's very shameful that this happened. So the Archbishop of New Orleans at that time was on the forefront of moving toward civil rights in his archdiocese and was opposed by some prominent Catholics. He was accused of meddling in politics. He was accused of, you know, taking the church back to the Dark Ages when he excommunicated those three prominent Catholics. I wanted to draw that parallel because abortion now is the paramount human rights issue of our day. And the same thing is happening. How can such a grave evil be condoned and gotten away with? If we think about what happened in the South, not only segregation, but even lynchings were carried on, and they were condoned, and people got away with it. And a lot of people didn't think that was a problem. How could they have been so blind? There's a certain cultural blindness that sets in that blinds people to the injustice, and it's reinforced by the powerful people in the society, and those who try to buck the trend are somehow harmed, they're ridiculed, they're marginalized, they're persecuted. It was very dangerous going from the North down to the South to campaign for civil rights. So it's that cultural blindness that sets in. I see the striking parallels to what's going on today with the cultural blindness with regard to the sanctity of life in the womb. Again, these are our brothers and sisters whom we should welcome into society. African Americans of the pre-civil rights South were not considered equal human beings, so they could be treated inferiorly. They could be treated without any regard for their basic human rights. This is now the attitude toward life in the womb. It's more complicated, I suppose, because we have a mother involved there, but you know, we also have a father involved. It's going to require a whole shift in our cultural attitudes toward valuing and considering as a blessing the woman's gift of fertility. You know, it's not a problem to be fixed. It's not a sort of an appliance with an on and off switch to be turned on and off at will. It's a great blessing and something we should value and esteem and protect and cherish, and everyone participate in that. So we need to break through the cultural blindness that's afflicting our society nowadays as it afflicted the pre-civil rights South.
Yeah, another thing I want to talk about are Catholic politicians, or as you say, self-professed Catholics who publicly and fervently support abortion. How do you think the church should respond?
This is very distressing because the church has always been the champion of human rights and has courageously advocated for human rights. We need to teach clearly, yes, but I often emphasize to be truly pro-life means embracing the woman with love and support. As I often say, a woman in a crisis pregnancy, the answer to her situation is not violence, it's love and support. I'm so proud of my fellow Catholics and people of other faith traditions as well, who run these pro-life crisis pregnancy clinics. They give the woman what she really needs. First of all, love, companionship, moral support, but also practical support with health care, with helping her get her life together even after the baby is born, with what she needs with diapers and blankets and baby formula, help her get job training if she wants to put the child up for adoption, walking her through that process. That's why I was very pleased to hear about what happened in Texas, that they got this right. It's not just a matter of making abortion illegal. If that's all we did and nothing more, it could even make the situation worse. We need to be very pro-life in the holistic sense and pro-woman. So they're investing $100 million in their alternatives to abortion program. So women really will have alternatives and can make a happy choice, a choice for life.
Yeah. Changing gears here quickly, as you know, the 52nd International Eucharistic Congress is taking place right now. Can you talk about the importance of it, especially now in these times?
Well, we have these two projects going on at the level of the U.S. Church with the bishops with the Eucharistic Coherence Document and also the Eucharistic Revival Project, which will begin in the local churches and the dioceses and then the parishes and culminating in a National Eucharistic Congress to try to revitalize our faith in the Eucharist, that this is the core Catholic faith. It's who we are, belief that this is truly the body, blood, soul, and divinity of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And if we lose that belief, we lose the Catholic faith. So we need to revitalize that. But hand in hand with that is what it means to receive the body and blood of Christ. It's not just a gesture of table fellowship, which would be a more Protestant understanding of communion, but it truly is Christ's sacrifice made present to us. And to receive means one must be in a state of grace. One must be in living a life in communion with the church, with what the church teaches, and life in conformity with that. So we need a large effort of recatechizing our people on this. And this is certainly in line with the teaching of the church from the beginning, and even more recently. The bishops are taking this phrase Eucharistic coherence from the Apodicita document. This was the great meeting of the Latin American bishops in Apodicita, Brazil, back in 2007, when they speak specifically about this, and they refer specifically to the issues of abortion and euthanasia and other direct attacks on human life. And they speak in reference to politicians, government leaders, and healthcare workers, that if they take positions advancing these evils such as abortion and euthanasia, and that there is an incoherence if they were to present themselves for communion. So we're as well, the then Archbishop of Buenos Aires, Cardinal Jorge Mario Bergoglio, was one of the key authors of that document. So that's where we're seeing that as one catalyst for this effort. We received a letter from the then Cardinal Ratzinger in 2004, who was the head of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, citing a document of theirs from 2 years before about Eucharistic coherence and specifically about Catholic politicians. Again, mentioning specifically the issues of abortion and euthanasia, that the pastor is to urge them, accompany them on a path to conversion on these issues, and if not, they're to be declared not to be admitted to communion. So we're certainly in keeping with what has been the constant perennial teaching and practice of the church with this. So the two kind of go together, the Eucharistic coherence, people understanding what it means to receive communion, and Eucharistic revival, revitalizing our faith in the real presence of Christ and understanding this is core to our Catholic identity.
Well, Your Excellency, thank you so much for your time today. We really appreciate it.
Okay, good. You're welcome. Thank you.